Hi, everybody. Welcome. Yay. Thanks for coming on tonight. Look at you. Some people are driving, some people are just getting home from work. Awesome. Yeah, so we're recording this session tonight. Are you happy? We're going to record it and we're going to figure out a way to get it uploaded on Facebook, maybe YouTube. I'm not sure yet, but we are recording it tonight, and the goal is to get it uploaded so that you can go back and watch it if you want. Okay. We are not going to record the deliverance part. Okay. Due to privacy. We want you to understand that that's important to us, privacy. And so if you are worried about, wow, am I going to be recorded if I, speak up and say I would like some prayer? You are not going to be recorded, okay? It's only the teaching portion, okay? So make sure everybody knows that. We're going to wait a few minutes, let some more people jump on. Do we have any testimonies over from this last week? Something great God did in your life? Anybody like to share? Okay, Lisa. Hi, Lisa.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. It was really interesting. And after the deliverance of my soul wound in the womb, God showed me that was my first wound. And I've been under attack ever since. So, no, it's really good because actually, I started reading Pigs in a Parlor and started learning some tools on how to walk in spiritual warfare. And so every time he's pushing me on something, I just start rebuking him. And just been amazing. I don't think that Satan thought I would ever get to my first wound, and hit the bottom, hit the bottom of the pile where it all started. I feel like, I don't know. I mean, as hard as everything has been, and the grief that I went through, the loss of opportunity with my mom, and how it changed my vision of life, not just my actions, my whole way I saw life. And I wasn't even aware, I was a creation growing, and it's just, it was hard. I was angry at first at Satan, and then I was sad at the loss. And so, and I feel like that journey will be a little longer, and I'm okay with that because there are some things I need to process with my mom through the steps. But I'm really super excited what God is showing me for how to use spiritual warfare to walk in deliverance. It was like I feel like I was missing a step. And all of this stuff since last week and reading the Pigs in the Parlor, I mean, reading the word, I'm studying Ephesians and my personal time. And so it's been amazing. I mean, it's been hard and amazing. And I don't want to stay stuck anymore. I didn't anyway, but I really don't know.
You know, when I chose the title for this offshoot ministry of Hardcore Christianity Steps to Freedom, I chose steps. If any of you have done the stair stepper at the gym, you know how difficult that can be. And walking up a flight of stairs, especially a very tall, long flight of stairs, is very difficult. And so when we walk up, we are taking our steps, each step to our freedom. And I give God, wow, glory to God, because in Corinthians it says that we have spiritual gifts. And it was one of the operating of the spiritual gifts. The Holy Spirit told me in the womb. And that began our conversation, which led to healing. Yeah.
Thank you for letting me share. It's been amazing.
Absolutely. It's great.
It's amazing. I feel like, I kind of feel like in some ways I really started the deliverance journey on my own, not my own merit, my own steps. Because I first initially got delivered in Kansas when Brother Mike was down there.
Oh,
It's so
okay.
funny because I lived in Arizona for a decade and I just moved back in 2020 to Nebraska and I never heard of hardcore ministry out there. And I went to school for psychology out there and still didn't hear. So just amazing that now it's like there's just all this stuff out there and I'm finally starting to see it for myself, you know. So just
No.
amazing. Thank you so much.
That's great, Lisa. Thanks for sharing. Wonderful. That is truly wonderful. We all, if you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit, and you have the ability to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And they're listed there in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 14. Talks about them. And I can't imagine, I can't do this ministry. I don't think anyone can do this ministry effectively without the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And so we must have them, and they're available to each one of us. And the Lord will reveal to you if you're struggling, with something, and you're like, I just don't know what the root cause is. I don't know what this is. He will reveal it to you. We have to sometimes shut the fear up. We have to quiet ourselves to hear, but he will speak to you, speak to us, and we don't always need a minister to help us. The Holy Spirit is the one who does the work. So, and I've talked with lots of women. I've read some books, and I went through my own journey of healing, have been for a long time. And this type of deliverance is just part of the steps to freedom. A lot of you have been, you've been going through your own personal healing journey for a very long time. And you're here because you're like, okay, I've done all that I can do. Now I need some help. I need some super to get to the next step. So that's great. All right. Someone said they'd like to get the miracle list. If you could send me an email, I'd be happy to send it to you at steps to freedom, ADC at gmail.com. So this is Steps of Freedom. Those of you who are just jumping on from maybe for the first time, for a ministry that is connected very closely with Brother Mike and the Hardcore Christianity. I'm here in Phoenix, Arizona, and I'm a counselor at the Arizona Deliverance Center. Tonight, we're going over the miracle list, and we're on number two. Number two talks about negative thoughts about yourself specifically. So there are negative thoughts in general. There are also what we call intrusive thoughts, but tonight we're going to talk about negative thoughts you have about yourself. And hopefully I'll bring some information to you, give you better understanding, maybe help you recognize the voice of the enemy speaking to you, because the enemy uses first person, right? You think it's yourself, oh, I'm so stupid. You think you're saying it to yourself, but it's really a spirit, an evil spirit that is speaking to you. And when you go, yeah, I am so stupid. You just came into agreement. You just yoked yourself together with that evil spirit. And now you're walking arm in arm, I'd like to say. So we want to come out of agreement with those things. So before we start, we're going to pray. Sister Jennifer, would you like to open us in prayer?
Hi, Sister Julie. Yes, open us
Thanks
up.
for being here tonight.
Heavenly Father, we come humbly before your throne of grace and mercy tonight, Lord. And I thank you for pouring your spirit out here on this meeting, Lord. I thank you for touching the hearts of every sister that has come here tonight. We thank you for all the healing and deliverance you're bringing, for all the revelation you're pouring out on each one of us, Lord. We're all in this journey and we're all looking toward you and one another for love and support. And I'm just so thankful that you have brought us here. This is divine appointments for each one of us, Lord. We come against every spirit of distraction in the name of Jesus, and I bind your power, all distraction, everything that would turn people away or distract them or keep their attention on other things. We just bind those spirits in the name of Jesus. I come against all discouragement and bind those spirits. I bind all fear in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord God, for opening our hearts and minds to receive tonight. Thank you for this blessing. Thank you for your anointing, Lord. Thank you for your healing and deliverance in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thanks. Thanks for that. All right. Where do we start? Let's see if you recognize some of this. Have you ever heard yourself saying this? I knew I would fail. Why do I even try? I am a loser. No one wants to be around me. Look at me screwing up again. Can't I just be normal? Who am I? Why am I even here? And who cares? Would anybody notice if I was gone? These are negative thoughts. And you might wonder, you know, where does that begin? And for most of us, it begins in childhood. So when we grow up in an atmosphere that we don't feel accepted, we are not protected, we feel unloved, then we develop these ways to protect ourselves, and we think, wow, there must be something wrong with me. Why am I not being loved? And then there's this internal conflict because you know, you're like, wow, this is my mom and my dad. They're supposed to love me, but I don't feel loved. And a lot of times it's legitimate. They're not loving you very well. Some of you grew up in homes that were really awful. And some of you grew up in homes, there's a spectrum, right? Some of you grew up in homes that were not awful. They were pretty, you know, pretty good. But for some reason, you still felt unloved. And you're like, well, why is that? I feel like the odd man out. I feel like an outcast. I don't feel like a part of the family. When I was in junior high school is when it launched for me. I would come home. I played sports. So I'd come home after sports late, around 6 o'clock at night, eat dinner, do my little portion of cleanup, and go straight to my room. I did not want to socialize with my family. My mom would call to me and say, come down and watch TV with us. And I would yell, no, I don't want to. I didn't feel welcomed. And there was really, I can't say my mom didn't try. She was loving, but she loved through, here's your food. I'm going to clean your room. I'm doing your laundry. She went to work every day. She worked very hard. She taught us right from wrong. She was a very good mother, but she lacked the nurture, the hugs, the cuddles, the kisses that as a young girl, I did need. And I don't have any memory of that at all. So, you know, there's that internal conflict that we grow up with. And then what happens, the body reacts to it. The person is rejected. Then the person rejects themselves. And that invites a spirit of infirmity. So we have quite a few people on here. Not a lot of faces, though. If you can turn on your camera for just a minute and say hi, that would be great. How many of you, maybe give a hand raise, you have some type of infirmity? Hello there. Thank you. Hi, Claudia. So nice to see you.
Hi.
So how many of you, oh, look at all these wonderful, beautiful faces. Thank you so much. Awesome. Great, 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 great. Be sure to get a picture of that, Stephanie. All these beautiful faces, love it. That's for me. How many of you struggle with infirmity of some sort, some disease, syndrome, illness? How many? You have some diagnosis or you have symptoms of something. Look at this. Almost 100% of the people on here are raising their hand. Did you know that 95% of the population on the planet Earth has some type of disease or infirmity? 95%. So I'm not surprised at all that the majority of you have some type of infirmity. And so when we go through our lives and we don't feel safe or accepted or loved in childhood, either by parents, by siblings, by aunts and uncles, cousins, maybe it started at school, it can invite a spirit of infirmity. And so I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. I want to bring to your attention so when we talk about you having these negative thoughts, right, and you're turning against yourself, it really turns into it's a lack of self-acceptance. It can turn into self-bitterness and self-hatred. And it is progressive. You don't start out with hating yourself, but that's the progression of it. And when you get to the point when you're bitter towards yourself, you love other people and you're probably a great lover of other people. You're a great help. You care, you have a lot of compassion, but when it comes to yourself, you're really hard on yourself. So this teaching is for you. Self-loathing develops over time. It's typically triggered by one or more factors. Okay. And I got this from like a Psychology Today type magazine. So it includes past trauma, perfectionism, false expectations, social comparisons, and several other learned behaviors. So we all know that evil spirits can get into the body, the brain, the soul through trauma. And so whether it was a big trauma, maybe a divorce of your parents, maybe it was some type of abuse, physical, there's sexual abuse, there's emotional abuse, that manipulating, there's the spiritual abuse. That is a very common, I hear it more and more these days about spiritual abuse, a father, a mother, you know, somebody in your life using scripture to guilt you, make you feel guilty, try to control your behavior, saying things that then make you feel like I'm afraid of God and he's mad at me and I'm just waiting for the hammer to come down on me. So that is all traumatic. And as children, they begin to view the world as unsafe and that people are dangerous. People cannot be trusted. And they interpret that as, you know, I'm not even worth being loved. And so the other contributing factor, I guess I would call it, is these false expectations. It is normal to want to be accepted, to be loved, to perform a task well. That's normal. However, sometimes our expectations of self can be so high and so unattainable by any human that we are destined to fail. We set ourselves up for failure. These extraordinary expectations often lead to us falling short and feeling we have failed, reinforcing the voice, you're a failure. You know, we want to please other people, especially women. We are nurturers. We want to love. We want to, yes, can I get you this? Can I help you with that? That's God created us that way. It helps us to be connected to other people. We may have learned over time that meeting the expectations of others works well. We might learn through social experiences that when other people are happy with us, we feel happy with ourselves. This is an unhealthy way of thinking about relationships that may lead to significant patterns of dependency, codependency. The next contributing factor to these negative thoughts and feeling really low of yourself is perfectionism. I know a lot of perfectionists. If you went to college, you met a lot of them. You have to perform, you have to do very well. Athletes, they have a high level of performance. People who are very, you know, in business, high level, very driven. A person is often viewed as someone who allows themselves no margin of error, no wiggle room for human mistakes or limitations. It's perfectionism. They expect perfection of themselves and others at all times and in all situations. And that's an unhealthy view of yourself and others. Because we fail. All have fallen short of the glory of God. There's only one man who was ever perfect on this planet, and that was Jesus. That is Jesus, right? We compare ourselves in social situations. That's a big voice, right? I look at somebody or you look at somebody and you're like, oh my gosh, that person's, you know, better looking than I am. They are thinner than me. They're more success. They're farther along in their deliverance than I am. Comparison, right? That's going to reinforce, that is going to feed the voice of self-hatred, self-bitterness. I like the scripture in 3 John 1:2. Third John only has one chapter. Sorry, verse 2. It says, "Dearly beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers." And when our soul is burdened with things like perfectionism and these high expectations, we're comparing ourselves to others a bunch. We're not seeing ourselves accurately. We have these false expectations, maybe false burdens. We're not prospering in our soul. I want to read this other scripture to you. It's Psalms 103:3-5. It says, "God is the God that forgives all of our iniquities and heals all our diseases." And so I see there that iniquities can be related to disease. Verse 4 says, "Who redeems your life from destruction." Maybe you felt that having a disease has brought destruction to your life. And God wants to redeem you from that destruction. He crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who feeds your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. The Lord desires for us to be in health, to prosper. He desires good things for us. And this is part of renewing the mind. You've heard that a bunch, right? You get deliverance, you got to renew your mind. Are you renewing your mind? And so what does that mean exactly? Well, you have to think about your thinking. Is your thinking lining up with the Word of God? What are you thinking about? What are you thinking about? There are these common spirits that you hear talked about a lot. The most common one is rejection, right? Rejection is definitely, it's like a tree that has all these branches connected to it. Deep, deep roots, rejection. We hear a lot about fear and lust and witchcraft, occultism, addiction, anger. There are a couple of spirits that I want to talk to you about tonight, just briefly. And I'm going to show you a little video. It's a little long, but it's very, very good. And it's talking about the different ways our body breaks down because of our thinking. These negative thoughts about ourselves begin with the spirit of accusation, accusing ourselves. Accusing ourselves. I am a bad person. I suck. Let's just say it, right? How many times have you said that? I'm such an idiot. How can I be so stupid? What is wrong with me? Right? You've thought these things. It's not you thinking them. That's the problem. And so we have to renew our mind. We have to change our thinking and really understand that that voice, oh my gosh, I forgot, you know, oh, wow, this is terrible. This is, you know, happening in my life. This, oh my gosh, thought, this frantic thought that rushes into your mind, I will tell you right now, it's not you. It's not you speaking. It's an evil spirit speaking, putting you in fear, getting you to accuse yourself, to condemn, to make you feel bad about yourself. Yeah. It's called the spirit of accusation. Think about, you have to slow yourself down to catch it. What are you accusing yourself of? What are you accusing other people of? The spirit of accusation is accusing you and telling you, you know, you're not good enough. You're unrighteous. You know, maybe you lost your salvation. Look at what a terrible week you just had. You know, that's not how it works. You're righteous because of what Jesus did on the cross. You are not righteous because of your right living. You are righteous because of what Jesus did. And only because of what Jesus did. Isn't that good news? That's the good news. That is the good news. So accusation, I have a couple things to read to you. So the goal of an accusing spirit is to break down relationships so that they do not function anymore. Some of the characteristics of an accusing spirit projects fear. Oh my gosh, what if you don't, you better call that person or they're going to think you don't care for them anymore. You don't care, or you're mad at them. Analyzing other people's motives towards you. You offend or are easily offended. That's the spirit of accusation and operation. You're quick to judge based on misunderstandings. Oh my gosh. Do I have a story for you? This is the craziest misunderstanding. I was at a friend's house, and I prepared a little food, and I was just gonna eat some, you know, kind of like, you know, let me just take the edge off and eat some food here, and because my friend had stepped out, so I said, no, let me wait and we'll eat together. Well, my friend comes back into the room and starts to season the food that I had prepared, which was fine because I didn't do that, and started eating it. He was tasting it. I thought that person started eating without me. Total misunderstanding. And I got so like offended. I was like, I waited for you and now you're eating without me. And that wasn't it at all. I'm just putting salt on it, making sure it's good for both of us. Okay. It was a complete misunderstanding, ridiculous. And I realized, wow, that I was accusing without even thinking. And I say I did it because it came out of my mouth. You know, the spirit put the thought in my mind. And then I said, yeah, that's what's happening. And then I spoke it. I yoked myself together with that spirit. Okay. Exaggerating offenses. You know, that person then put a napkin down by my plate on the table. Oh, they must, you know, they did it on purpose just to get back at me from last week's, you know, this imagination, this exaggeration of offenses. Do you use the terms, the word always and never? That's actually from a spirit of accusation. The other spirit that you're going to hear about in the video clip that I'm going to share in a minute is called the unloving spirit. How many of you have heard of the unloving spirit? Okay, a few of you. So good. The unloving spirit is a spirit that attaches itself to you, making you feel self-rejected. You reject yourself, unclean, unworthy, and no good, and that you don't measure up. It wants you to reject yourself and who you are. The evidence of an unloving spirit, it wants you to dislike yourself based on your outward appearance, your voice, your personality, everything about you. It will nitpick you to death, the unloving spirit. It wants you to debate with yourself as to whether you belong here or not. Have you ever said that? I better just leave. I better just not even go. I don't belong there. These other people belong there, but not me. It wants you to think others hate you because you can see it in their eyes. Yes, thank you, Patricia. The unloving spirit is the same as the Antichrist. Yeah. The unloving spirit wants you to isolate and not be in fellowship with others. It thrives in isolation. If we're in isolation, we cannot fulfill the greatest commandment. Jesus gave us two commandments. He said, okay, all the law, all the rules and regulations from the Old Testament are summed up in these two laws. Remember what they are? Matthew 22, 37. Jesus said unto them, thou shalt love the Lord God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. If you're in isolation, you can't be loving other people because you're not around other people. And if you're not properly biblically loving yourself, it's going to be expressed in your relationships with other people. So I want to take a break here, and I want to share this video. And if you were on last week, you know, I am using a lot of information from a ministry called Be In Health. They're in Thomaston, Georgia. I went there a few weeks ago. And when I look at the miracle list, I say, okay, these are the spirits that we, you know, need to focus on. Unforgiveness. That was number one, right? We got to forgive. And number two is talking about negative thoughts towards yourself, which really is self-rejection, self-bitterness, self-hatred, right? So what are the spirits, which I just listed a bunch, and then what effect does it have on the body? So the Be In Health ministry, their whole ministry is centered around the spiritual roots to disease. Okay. This is a book that I'm gathering information from. And if you're struggling with a disease or syndrome, it might be a good book for you to get to learn about what are the spiritual roots to disease. This ministry, this book, and some others, A More Excellent Way, based on 30 years of research. And so what I'm doing is, in this class, this round, I'm taking what I learned when I went to that retreat. I'm sharing some videos, sharing some information with you to help help you understand what's going on and to help motivate you. If you may not have any disease or sickness in your body, but you know you have negative thoughts about yourself. Well, if you continue to have negative thoughts about yourself and you don't change, what will happen? You'll get sick. Because the body responds to thought. There is new scientific research, relatively new, that has connected thought to the disease. And so if we don't renew our mind the way the Bible tells us to, we're going to end up sick. We're going to end up inviting that spirit of infirmity. And then then life is not good. It's not fun. It really keeps us in bondage. It really does. So I'm going to attempt to share this video. Once again, I did it last week and we'll do it again.
See it.
Well, hey everybody. My name is David Levitt with Be In Health and Hope of the Generations. And today I want to talk to you about the subject of the unloving spirit. In fact, it's not a subject at all. It's a spirit that we're going to be talking about. And here in Thompson, Georgia, at our For My Life retreat that we hold once a month, we dive deeper into this topic. But today, I think you may just find the answer as to why you might feel separated from God your Father. So, I want to start by reading a scripture here. You can find it in Matthew 22, verses 34 through 40. And this is really the foundation for all that we're going to talk about in our time together. So Matthew 22, starting in verse 34. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, "Master, which is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said unto him, "Listen, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment." Now, Jesus does not just stop here. There's another commandment that he wants to instill here. Verse 39, "And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." It's a really startling statement by Jesus, because what that means is that the totality of the Bible really represents three things: love with God, loving and accepting ourselves, and loving others. Now, many of you know that scripture, but it's become such a cliche in the church. We use it all the time. But the truth is, if I was to ask you the question, do you struggle with things that cause you to do the exact opposite of what this scripture represents? I think many of you would say yes. At the same time, many of you would have a hard time admitting to that because you feel like it's a personal failure to not be able to live up to this verse. And that is exactly where I want to start with this unloving spirit. You know, we are born again. We do love God. But we struggle to love God, ourselves, and others sometimes. Some of us more than others, okay? But I want to tell you this. It's not you. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more, how this unloving spirit is not you, and those thoughts and feelings and emotions that come to resist you loving God, yourself, and others, you can actually overcome it. But right now, we feel stuck with it, and we hate it. And the tragedy is that we end up hating ourselves. And that is exactly what an unloving spirit wants you to do. An unloving spirit is an evil spirit that will resist you receiving and accepting everything that Father God has done for us through Jesus Christ. It will give you thoughts, feelings, and impressions that cause a breach between God, yourself, and others. So here's how it kind of works. The Bible says that you are forgiven, right? But an unloving spirit comes along and says, "No, you're not." The Bible says that God loves you. But an unloving spirit comes along and says, "Nope, he's mad at you." An unloving spirit, really, what it wants to do, y'all, is make you your own worst enemy. But here's the problem with that. When you look at Ephesians 6:12, it says this, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Are you flesh and blood? Yes, you are. So don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and spiritual wickedness in high places. So during this time together, I really want you to see that this thing is not you. But we struggle because it speaks to us in the first person. I know the thoughts that come. I know that we struggle with thoughts like, I'm so dumb. I don't measure up. I never do anything right. It's not like we have thoughts that are like, you don't ever do anything right, or you don't measure up. It's always in the first person. And because we're thinking it, we buy it as if it's our own mind, not knowing that we may have just come into agreement with an unloving spirit. And when we do that, we will struggle with this scripture I just talked about, loving God, yourself, and others. So we try harder, but we fail. So we try harder again, and we fail again. And then we hate ourselves more and more. We try really hard to believe, but then an unloving spirit comes and makes us believe that we can't believe. You may even find yourself not just blaming yourself for this struggle, but beginning to blame others as well. Basically, the unloving spirit has you spend your day in a world in which you never measure up. And I'll tell you, guilt is a huge factor in the unloving spirit. You know, I've been a believer for over 15 years. I've been in full-time ministry for over 10 years. I have spoken with thousands of people, not at surface level either, but the real depths of their heart. And these are people that are born again. And I don't think I've met one yet that hasn't struggled with guilt and shame and not loving themselves at some level. Like I said, some more than others. You and I were called to receive forgiveness, receive love from God, and enjoy that and give it out to others. At Being Health, we deal a lot with specific spiritual roots to disease. And this unloving spirit is a major spiritual root behind many, many diseases, and many of them life-threatening. First one on top of the list would be autoimmune diseases. In fact, all autoimmune diseases are rooted in not loving yourself. Feeling guilty, feeling shame, not feeling forgiven, making yourself the enemy, blaming yourself for everything, even though you're forgiven. Think about it. Let's think about it. What is an autoimmune disease? Well, an autoimmune disease, by medical definition, is when the immune system in our body begins to attack the body. So, for example, in diabetes 1, the immune system begins to attack the islets on the pancreas, inhibiting insulin production. With lupus, the immune system begins to eat away at the connective tissue of the body. Rheumatoid arthritis, it begins to eat away at the joints and the cartilage. In Crohn's, it begins to eat away at the inner lining of the intestines. And these are just a few of over 100 autoimmune diseases. Now, what's the common factor? The immune system is attacking the body. Y'all, God gave you your immune system to protect you. To protect you from the real enemy and foreign invaders that could actually do harm to your body. But instead, the immune system is attacking the body. Why? I'll tell you why. Because our bodies are responders to how we think. And as we think about not loving ourselves, we meditate on that, not receiving God's forgiveness, over time, the immune system begins to pick up on our thinking and actually begins to attack the body. Let me read you a really great testimony here of some healing that we saw here at For My Life from a major autoimmune disease. This is Lauren, okay? Here's her story. She says this, I have some incredible healing. Back in 2013, I was going through some terrible symptoms with lupus, which is an autoimmune disease. I was in and out of the hospital several times. My kidneys were not working properly. And I had terrible joint swelling over my entire body. I couldn't even make a fist or bend my arm fully because my joints were constantly swollen. I had the lupus butterfly rash on my face, and I had visible bumps around my joints because of the inflammation. When I received the diagnosis of lupus, I did not want to believe it. I was given medication, but it didn't help. And in one case, I was severely allergic to a medication which caused an awful rash all over my body. the doctors told me that, quote, the torch had been lit and that there was no cure, and I would have this the rest of my life. I walked out of that office and into the hallway, but before I even left the building, I called my sister and I said, I refuse to accept this diagnosis, but I am desperate. I need to know what they taught you in Georgia. I mean, Thomason, Georgia, where we're at. Her sister had previously attended the For My Life retreat and been healed of something else. So Lauren continues to say this, I attended the Be in Health For My Life retreat and learned the truth. I had to remind myself that I was going to be healed and that the lupus was not me. It was just affecting me. I thank God for the healing that I knew was eventually coming. I continued to take my thoughts captive, and now listen, and to remind myself that I was forgiven by God. That's so huge. And that I no longer needed to punish myself for past sins. This unloving spirit will have you punish yourself for past failures. Exactly what Christ died for, so that you didn't have to punish yourself. She goes on to say, I also had to cast down thoughts that would make me feel guilty for what I had done nearly 10 years prior. I repented and I knew I was forgiven by God. And I also continued to cast out evil things that were causing those bad thoughts and reminders of past sins to pop into my head. Over time, I gradually started to get better, and I can say now with full confidence that God healed me of the lupus. What is even more amazing is that I recently had my first child, a healthy baby boy. The doctors had told me that I was high risk for pregnancy complications because of the lupus. I had an ultrasound every week for 12 weeks in a row at one point, but week after week, I got great news, the baby was healthy. I feel so incredibly blessed for the healing from lupus, and that I was able to have a healthy child. After the healing from lupus and my pregnancy, I'm even back to doing gymnastics and water skiing again. It's pretty good for somebody that could not close their fist at one point. My health has been fully restored. The doctors rarely see healings like this happen because my rheumatologist still has me come in for blood tests periodically. And for 2 years now, every time they test me, I have normal results. Thank you, God. Amazing. You know, an unloving spirit's behind all autoimmune diseases, but also many other diseases. Certain types of cancers, certain types of cardiovascular disease, addictions, and even mental illnesses have a root and component of not being able to love and accept oneself and know that they are forgiven. Why? Because when you don't dwell in love, you actually dwell in fear. 1 John 4:18, very important scripture, says this, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear has torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. Are you struggling with love? Are you struggling with forgiveness towards yourself and others? I'll tell you, the number one way an unloving spirit gets into somebody's life is when someone who is supposed to love and cover them and protect them failed to do so. And the abuse and the anger and rage that they took in through that victimization, they took right into themselves, and this spirit caused them to internalize it and then blame themselves for all the problems. Do you struggle giving and receiving love without fear? If so, you may be struggling with an unloving spirit. And that's great news, because it means you're not the problem and that you can be free from it. And we have seen hundreds, if not thousands, of people who struggle with themselves, hated themselves, had diseases and addictions and problems that all stem out of not receiving God's forgiveness and loving and accepting themselves, completely changed and healed and delivered. Why? Not because they got smarter, not because they were finally able to make the change, but because they received. They were able to understand that these thoughts and feelings were not them. And then they were able to finally accept who they really are in the Word. I want to do.
Okay. Did that stop? All right. So I didn't want to go. What'd you guys think about that video? Yeah, good. We are going to pray tonight, of course, but I want to go over a couple more, list a couple more of these diseases that, or syndromes actually, that are affected, that have spiritual roots in self-esteem issues, self-bitterness, self-rejection, okay? Before I do that, I want to say the greatest thing, the greatest news that I keep hearing it again and again, those negative thoughts, those negative bombarding thoughts that I'm not good enough, I'm not forgiven, I'm never going to make it, this is my life forever, those are not my thoughts, and those are not your thoughts. And when you start to come out of agreement, that means you start rejecting those thoughts, then you have to reject them. No, that's not me talking. No, I'm not listening to you. Get away from me. Get out of me. You know, it doesn't matter. Is the devil inside? Is he on the outside? It doesn't really matter. You just want him gone, right? We just want him gone. We want him to shut his mouth and leave. There's a few I wanted to go over with you that I found really interesting. Premenstrual dysphoric disorder. So this is a severe form of premenstrual syndrome. Did anyone have a very, very difficult time with their period when they were younger, or maybe you still do now? Lots of pain, lots of cramping. It says that causes marked social impairment in approximately 5 in 100 women. Women can present with multiple symptoms such as fatigue, headache, feelings of hopelessness, irritability, and bloating. Okay, I think that's all of us, right? But was it severe, I guess? These occur exclusively in 10 to 14, excuse me. These symptoms occur exclusively in the 10 to 14 days before the menses. So, you know, that list right there is basic PMS, right? We all experience PMS. So this dysphoric disorder, premenstrual, is called PMDD, is a more extreme, more severe form of it. Anybody ever diagnosed with that here? The PMDD, anybody? Oh, Ellen. Okay, I'm looking, anybody? Okay. All right, Ellen, well, you read this already. Okay, so someone must have just jumped on. So here we go. The possible spiritual roots. Guess what? Spirit of fear. I hate that thing. As in stress and anxiety, lack of self-esteem, self-bitterness, self-hatred, self-rejection, guilt. Spirits that may have gained access as a result of lack of nurturing, sometimes not accepting oneself as a female. How many of you were born and your parents were like, dang it, I wanted a boy. Yeah. I had three brothers and I always said, man, they wish I was a boy too, because it seemed like, you know, they got to go to work with my dad, which was favored. I had to stay home and like do housework. Oh, I hated that. There was such a discrepancy there. I wanted to learn how to pound nails and make things too. You know, lack of nurturing. If we don't feel comfortable when people are trying to get their love to us, we're going to exclude ourselves from that environment, which is going to prevent us from getting the nurturing that we need. Like me in junior high school, I took myself, my mom, you know, she said, come and be with the family. Let's watch whatever sitcom was on. And I was like, no, I'm separating myself from the family. And I started doing that around 12, 13 years old. Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, people are commenting right now. A lot of rejection happens. Not accepting oneself as a female can cause, you know, that excessive bleeding, a lot of fatigue and depression, irritability, that a very extreme form. I thought that was really interesting. Another a disorder that came up is attention deficit disorder. Anyone ever been diagnosed with that? I was. Anybody? Just raise your hand if, or just wave at me. Anybody ever diagnosed with ADHD or ADD? Okay. All right, here we go. Possible spiritual roots. Generational spirits of ungodly order in the home. Passive male and dominant female. Okay, before I go back over that, hold on a second. Attention deficit disorder is characterized by inattention, disorganized, and difficulty completing tasks. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder consists of motor hyperactivity and impulsive behavior. Okay, the spiritual roots. Generational spirits of ungodly order in the home. Passive male and dominant female. Leading to double-mindedness, deaf and dumb spirit, confusion, rebellion, here it is, self-bitterness, self-hatred, self-rejection, and guilt. This spirit, these spirits that are telling you all these negative thoughts about yourself, this is what it is. It's self-bitterness, self-hatred, self-rejection, and guilt. All right, addictions. Addictive behaviors represent confusing and complex patterns of the human activity. These behaviors include drug and alcohol abuse, some eating disorders, some compulsive or pathological gambling, excessive sexual behaviors, and other intemperament behavior patterns. Okay, we have to look that up. Possible spiritual roots to these addictions, rooted in the need to be loved, feeling insecure in being loved. What we are addicted to allows us to avoid ourselves by giving us a poor substitute for love in order to be fulfilled or to fill the void. Addictions are an escape mechanism, works in conjunction with the unloving spirit. Do you guys see a pattern? Okay, which can be seen along with self-accusation, self-hatred, guilt, and shame. This is a type of self-fear, fear of man, also considered performance issues in competition, coming out of feeling inadequate. Is this helping anybody? Are these helping you maybe identify what might be going on in there with you? Okay. A goiter here. Medical definition is the enlargement of the thyroid. There are a number of factors which may cause the thyroid to become enlarged. A diet deficient in iodine can cause a goiter. A more common cause of goiter in America is an increase in the thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH. In response to a defect in normal hormone synthesis within the thyroid gland. Okay, possible spiritual roots. Spirits of, can you guess? Fear, as in stress and anxiety. Self-bitterness, self-hatred, self-rejection, and guilt. Drivenness and performance. Possibly not taking proper care of your temple, your body. All right. Can I say this word? This is a gastric condition. It's a severe, there's several different types of cancer that can occur in the stomach. And so the most common type is called adenocarcinoma. Did I say that right? Where's Ellen? Okay, it's a very long word. I think it's adenocarcinoma, which refers to the way the cancer looks under the microscope. Often occurs when the stomach meets the esophagus. It's right where your bra strap hits, right there. So there's a soul-mind connection, being overly concerned and in knots or all tied up about what other people think of you and your performance. If you fail, you blame yourself. So this is a type of gastric cancer that they found these possible spiritual roots. Spiritually, fear of man leading to extreme self-bitterness, rebellion, spirit of infirmity, spirit of death. And the last one I'm going to read is cancer, colon cancer. My uncle actually died from colon cancer, and it's a very terrible death. It's a terrible cancer. All cancer is terrible. But cancer in the colon or the rectum, it's called Lynch syndrome, is a rare inherited condition that increases your risk of colon and other cancers that has historically been known as hereditary non-polyposis. Okay, HNPCC. I'm not going to say the whole word. Okay, possible spiritual roots to this type of colon cancer is generational slander with the tongue. Slander with the tongue. Habitual defiling of others with the tongue. What you're saying about other people. Generational critical spirit, generational accusation against yourself, others, or God, fear as in stress and anxiety, and death. So those are the possible spiritual roots to that type of colon cancer. All right. Since I've been learning more about the spiritual roots, I feel really motivated to start really catching my thoughts, stop accusing myself and others, checking in with God more often. How am I doing? Repenting quickly, forgiving almost immediately. This is no joke. We have to take the word of God seriously. We have to. Now, there are some people on here, maybe you don't have any physical ailment and you're like, yeah, well, you know, I'm fine. That's not going to, you know, that doesn't affect me. But see, this is progressive. So if you recognize that you have these negative thoughts that come into your mind and you're not catching them and rejecting them, then your door is open for more of these spirits to come in. And it will start attacking. Your body will turn on itself. It will do it. So number two on the miracle list, okay? This is your homework. I didn't even check in with you. I hope you all did last week's homework. This week, you are focusing on, you're really paying attention to, what am I thinking about? Is that a negative thought about myself? Is that a negative thought about somebody else? But really about yourself. How are you thinking? What are the top negative thoughts? Now I got to put my glasses on, because if you've ever seen the Miracle List by Brother Mike, the font is like this big. Okay. Number two says, make a literal numbered list of all the things you don't like about yourself. I hope you don't need another notebook. Okay. Good. Somebody laughed. Excellent. All the things you don't like about yourself, and repent over each one of them. Release and forgive yourself. This is a process. Okay. I want you to work really hard over this next week. Pray hard and release the negative feelings you have for yourself. Release your mistakes and regrets. Paul said, I don't look behind myself anymore. I only look ahead towards the prize. Okay, you have to forget what's behind and look ahead. You need to release your mistakes and regrets Don't stop until all the emotion of self-disgust, self-hate, condemnation, I'm going to throw in guilt, are gone. If you have bad feelings about yourself, it will block your recovery and your deliverance. Self-hatred is as bad as hating other people. And we know we can't do that. So that is the homework, okay? If you do not have the miracle list, we're working from the miracle list for troubled Christians. Please send me an email, or you can email Brother Mike at hardcorechristianity.com. Mike at hardcorechristianity.com is, you can email Mike. You can email me at stepstofreedomadc@gmail.com, and I'll send you a copy. Yeah, so that's it for tonight. Is there any questions?
Could you repeat the steps to freedom ADC at what?
Gmail.com.
Thank you.
There we go. We just posted it in the chat. Thanks, Stephanie.